Hi, this is David with EdgeStar Technical Support. Today we're going to cover the Cold Front TWR-187SS stainless steel wine cooler. We're going to cover advanced component replacement. We'll show you each component and how it's replaced and why we might replace it. All right, here we have the Cold Front TWR-187SS. This is the back of the unit. What I'm going to do in this first segment is I'm going to give you a general overview of what's going on at the back of the wine cooler here. Some possible fail modes, kind of what goes on, what takes place, and then in my next segment we'll talk about each individual component and how it's replaced. And this is more of a in-depth diagnostic more than it is anything else. So really this video is meant for a technician or somebody who has advanced knowledge of electronics. This isn't really meant for the average consumer because they won't be back here working on this unit. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through each one kind of in a circular pattern, and then in our next segment we'll get into individual diagnostics and we'll do that same pattern on the diagnostics. So I've got it running here. It's fired up. It's plugged in. So first thing we're going to talk about is power input, and this is where our power comes in. And remember folks, safety first. As a technician, that should be first and foremost in your mind. I'm actually having it plugged in just as an illustration here, but obviously when the unit's unplugged it's a lot safer. Bear in mind there are capacitors in here, there's a couple of resistors and some other MOSFET circuitry that will remain powered up for some time after the unit's unplugged. So I would probably unplug it, leave it sit for about half an hour, and then you can safely begin working on it. Remember to discharge any static electricity. Obviously the circuit boards are going to be sensitive to that. Those are all things that are common knowledge to the technicians. So first thing we're going to talk about here is power input. We do have a filter board here. We have a choke coil here in the center. You can see it, that copper colored coil there wrapped with the green tape. That's to prevent RFI interference. And we also have on the board here underneath, and next to that coil we have some MOVs, some metal oxide varistors. That helps in a surge. It will take out the MOVs. Obviously the varistor will absorb so much energy and then it will fail. So we may get several spikes out of this board before it eventually fails. The good thing about it though is that when that spike hits, the board will absorb that energy. We're not going to transmit it over here to the circuit board, which obviously can be catastrophic in certain situations. And also, speaking of circuit boards, just so that you know, these are switching power supply. So we have 9 volts to start it, kicks at the butt, and then the capacitors take over after that, and then we start providing that 12 volts. So just remember that these are a switching power supply. These are not a straight circuit board. So moving along, of course we have our cooling fans. And the cooling fans will run all the time, and there's a set of fans inside as well. So we have a total of 4. So we have 4 fans in here, 2 on the back side of this wall, and then this divider wall in here, and we have 2 on the inside. And fans generally will do one of 2 things. They either make a lot of noise, they get really noisy and raggedy, or they just quit altogether. More often than not, they'll just get noisy, and they'll become more and more so over time. And so at that point we'd want to replace them. Circuit boards, which are basically the heart of the unit. And these boards are identical, they're just in different positions. And those boards are susceptible to a lot of things, so we need to make sure that we ground ourselves and we discharge any static electricity from this. You may want to wear an ESD strap just to protect yourself. But the boards basically only have one failure mode. They either work or they don't. And as you can see, there's a couple of LEDs in here. One of them's green and one of them's red. There's one on each board. Red would indicate the power is being applied to the board, so we have 120 volts coming into the board that's being distributed, and we have 12 volts going out the other side, which go to the cooling nodes. Our green light here, which you can't see real well because it's a dull kind of green, with the ambient light in here it doesn't show up real well, that indicates that node activation is taking place. So we have our Peltier units, which is the official name of those cooling nodes, which is the term that we use. That indicates that 12 volts DC is being fed to each one of those. There is no self-diagnostic capability on the boards. other than you seeing power applied and node activation. If we get into a situation where everything looks good, we don't have any blinking lights here on these LEDs, and I'll get into that in the next segment, by the way, and everything looks good, but it's not cooling, at that point, we need to unplug the unit, backtrack for the cooling node in here, and we can check resistance on the board, it's on the cooling node itself, the cooling board or cooling node. We can check resistance. We can also check input power from the board to make sure that we're not getting a false indicator here where it says, hey, I'm applying power to the node, when in reality it's not. And that's rare, but you need to check both for continuity, voltage, and of course resistance on those nodes, and that will kind of help us isolate the problem. The other board over here, which is in the corner, this is our defrost board. Under certain circumstances, we can get ice buildup on the inside wall in here with the cooling node running so cold that any moisture in the air that contacts our heat sink on the other side, or actually our cold sink, so, and I'll get into those terms in a little bit, but it can build ice up on that cold sink, and then what will happen is it gets into the fan, and then it tears up the fan, makes a lot of noise. What we've done with this one is an improvement. We have a PTC sensor, positive temperature coefficient, which basically says I'm going to monitor the temperature of that cooling node and the cold side of the sink to make sure I don't get excessively cold, because I know if I do, then at that point I'm going to build up ice. And what it does is, if it does happen to drop that low and it starts to build ice, the unit will disengage the cooling nodes temporarily for a fixed amount of time in order for that to melt off a little bit, and then it'll restore normal operation. So all of these things work together in harmony to make the unit work, and then again in our next segment I'll cover each component in detail. Alright, so I want to show you a couple of the tools that you're going to be using while you're doing this, and for the average technician they only need a few basic tools. Obviously here I've got a power driver that I can use, and that's really helpful when you get the back off of these units because there are so many screws, and they're just helpful because most of the time they have a magnetic tip, you don't lose screws, things like that. What I don't have here is a magnetic bowl. I like to use a magnetic bowl for my screws so I don't lose them. You can find those at any hardware store or automotive store. The next item up here that we're going to be using is a standard multimeter. We use that for diagnostic checks. I'm going to show you a little bit how that's done. I'm going to get into some diagnostics on this unit. And then, of course, in those tight spots where you can't get that power driver, you're going to want just a manual number two Phillips. Should do the job quite nicely. So, let's talk about diagnostics just a little bit. If we get a cooler in for service, let's say a cooler arrives at your shop, and we don't have any power, on these units, the first thing we're going to want to do is check power in and power out. And for that, you're going to need your multimeter. Now, again, there's two sides to this unit. So we have a 12-volt DC side, and then we have a 120-volt AC side. So our first complaint, let's say we don't have any power. It's not powering up. It's not doing anything. And we notice that those red and green lights, they're not doing anything. They're not on at all. No red, no green, no signs of life. The fans aren't turning. We've got nothing. So the first thing we want to check is make sure that we have power to the unit. And you can verify that with the outlet that you use with something known that's good, that you know that works. So once we've done that and we've got that part isolated, now we need to check our filter over here, our power input board, and make sure that we have power being distributed out of that board. Because again, that board is designed to absorb those electrical spikes during storms. And what may have happened is that our MOVs in here, our metal oxide varistors, have absorbed the maximum amount of energy that they're going to absorb. And at that point, well, the whole board just shuts down because it's designed that way to kill the power to the board once it's reached its maximum saturation limit. So first thing we're going to do is, I'm going to step over here, is we're going to check our power coming in and our power going out. So of course, we're going to set our meter to AC volts. This one here starts out at, we could probably do 200 or 750. Now your meter is going to be different, but you should know how your meter works already. So we're going to set this for AC voltage. we would plug the unit in, and we're going to back probe this connector, and that will tell us, this one coming in here with this ground lead, and that will tell us whether we have power coming in. Once we've determined whether we do or we don't, and in this case we'll assume that we do, we're going to come up here and we're going to back probe these. And you can do these by just back probing these connectors, or you can come up here and you can back probe off this side of the connector. This one's reversed, but you can do the same. The other thing that you can do is to just come in here, and you can also check the tracers on the back side of the board. Now, I'm not going to remove the board in this case. We've got four screws that hold it in. Where I've back probed, that should be sufficient, because we have power coming out. We should have 120 volts coming out of here and coming out of here. Now that comes over here, and you can also check here and here. You're just going to follow your power wires, and you would come in here and back probe on this one, and then of course back probe on this one as well, and that will tell us whether we're getting that power distribution. If we've got power coming in but we've got nothing coming out, then we need to replace that board. So you'll need to call customer service. We'll get the board ordered and we'll get it out to you. So the next thing we're going to cover here is fan operation. Again, I told you we're going to go in kind of a circular pattern. So fans, I'll walk back over here. Fans, as I said earlier, either work or they don't, or they're just noisy. In either case, we would replace the fans. Now you'll see here all these wires come into this great big bundle. And what you would typically do is cut off that zip tie, which I'm not going to do here in this video. We cut off the zip tie, and then we come in here and we find our wires that go to the fan, and they'll be coming right out of the top of this bracket here, and as you can see here at the bottom as well. We're going to trace them over, and you'll find on these boards they're actually marked. So you have fan over here, and then over here you have another fan plug-in. It's this black connector. So what we would do to check the fan, so we're just going to unplug that from the board. And again, these are just male, female plug-ins. There's really nothing to them. They just unplug. And what we would do here, the first thing I would do is take my meter and I would set it for ohms resistance. In this case, I'd probably set it for about 200,000 ohms. And what we would do is we would come in here, and you can do this one of two ways. You can either do it like this, which is a little tough to do, and you'd back probe these two shiny connectors here at the end, or better yet, you could take a piece of bread tie, small gauge wire, stick it into the terminals here at the end of the plug, let them stick out. You can use your meter with some alligator clips, and you would just clip onto the ends of your jumper that you put on there, and that will tell us whether the fan's any good or not. So these fans, again, they either work or they don't. So we either have a resistance reading or we have open or infinity. And so if you have an infinity situation where the unit, the fans just doesn't have any resistance, at that point we take the fan out. And to get that fan out, basically all you need to do is you're going to clip your bundle here, disconnect your wire from the board here, and you're going to come and take these four screws out. There's a screw at each corner, and then that whole fan just backs out of there. So to replace it, you put the screws back in with the new fan, and then come over here, and then we're going to plug in our connector for our fans. So, and this other one here works exactly the same way. Again, these boards are identical. So when I refer to one board, I'm actually referring to both. So the procedure is the same whether it be this one or this one. And by the way, when you spin these fans, they should have a bit of a jerky action. As you can see, it kind of jerks and stops. That's normal. If you spin this by hand and you get a grating sound or a growling sound, there's a little cone bearing in the back of this. And what I would do to double check that fan, spin it by hand, listen for the bearing noise. If you hear something in there, what you can do is take this fan off and flip it around. And on the back side of this, there's a sticker, and it's got a model number and all that stuff on the fan itself. Peel the sticker back, take some silicone lube and give it a quick burst of silicone lube inside this area back in here on the opposite side of this fan, put the sticker back on and run it. If it gets quiet, we know that's the bearing for sure. So that's a double check. If you hear the noise and you hit it with some lubricant and it goes away, then we know the fan's bad for sure. And that goes for both of these fans and the two fans that are inside here. You can do the same for both of those. Now, as far as these circuit boards are concerned, you really don't need a soldering iron here. I think I had that laying here on the table to begin with. And there are some situations where you may have to solder some stuff to make repairs. But I'll tell you, both of these boards are all plug and play. This unit here, and there's one other unit just like it so far in our lineup, they have plug and play, total plug and play boards. So you don't have to worry about it. On a typical wine cooler, thermoelectric, we have a positive and negative lead coming out of each cooling node. Those get permanently soldered to the board. In this case, we don't have to do that. And if you look, there's a big connector here, right here. It's a three prong, pretty good size one. And then there's another one down here on this board, and it's a black one with a center stripe here. Both of these have PTCs in the back of them. So what you're going to find when you take this apart, there's another aluminum block inside of there that houses a PTC sensor to monitor this side of the cooling platform on this side of the heatsink. So we have temperature monitoring on both sides. Anyway, all that plugs into this connector here. So you have a positive, negative, and then the center one usually would be our PTC sensor. So you just unplug those from the board, and then you can remove the board, and all you would do is take these support screws out, and there's usually four of them, and there might occasionally be one in the center, but on this one you've got one at each corner. So you unplug everything. Be sure to mark all of your connections. That's very important. You can mark them based on what the circuit board says, because the circuit board at each connector is marked CN1, CN2, things like that. So you would mark it with a piece of tape and then unplug it. That way you don't get confused later on. Or you could, the other way you could do this is to unplug one board totally. You wouldn't really have to worry about it too much, because again, they're identical, and you would just use the other board for reference. Kind of like you would if you were doing brakes on a car. You'd take the one apart but leave the other one intact so you can see what you're doing. So these boards are just replaced as a single module. You would call customer service, order the board, comes in, you put the screws in and attach it to the back of the unit and plug everything into it. And that's really all that you need to do. And then of course you would power the unit up, make sure it's cooling, make sure that our LED lights red solid all the time and green. And by the way, let me get into that for a minute. On these LED lights, that red light that indicates that power is applied to the board, that one's going to stay on all the time. The green one that indicates node activation is dependent upon the thermostat setting that we have it at. So what we're going to see is an occasional cycle. So we'll see a period where that green light is off, and then it comes back on, and then it goes off again, and then it comes back on, so and so forth. So that one we should get an occasional pulse out of it. The red light should stay constantly on all the time. If you see any kind of indication in here where something's wrong, let's say for example both lights have a fast flash, we know that the switching part of the board is probably defective, because when those lights come on, it's trying to switch power to the other side of the board to get that board started, but then we lose something in that process. We have a defective component, so it gets into this continuous kind of loop where it'll start, stop, start, stop, and that's where we get that flash at. Or the other situation, which is fairly rare, is that we would get no red indicator light at all. The green light may flash a little bit or be on really weak or really dim. If you see any of that, odds are it's a circuit board. Again, those LEDs are a pretty good telltale. They're not 100% accurate, but for general purposes, we would use those to diagnose the board. And that's really our only window into what the board is doing. And by the way, there are some things you may do with it powered on. Now, I've told you in the beginning to make sure the unit's unplugged, but obviously there are things that we need to do with the unit plugged in. And I will tell you that if you look here, these heat sinks here and this one, both of these here, they actually have a transistor that's actually sealed to them with some conductive grease. And I will tell you from personal experience, if you hit one of those, please don't have your hand on this cabinet. Because if I hit that, I'm running a couple amps through me and it's going right through my heart. I'm dead as a doornail. So make sure that you're not touching this cabinet. If you do bump one of those, please be very careful. The reference voltage on those is about 300 volts DC. That's no joke. That's really what they are. And so these provide a grounding path, and of course they complete the circuit. But if this unit's powered on, please don't touch either one of these. Very, very important. Your life depends on it. So just a safety aspect here. So we've talked about our fans. We've talked about our input over here. We've talked about our circuit boards and what they do. And occasionally also, by the way, on these circuit boards, you're going to find that the board won't power up. And it obviously has a defective component. We've got scorch marks. We've got arcing. It's plainly obvious that something on the board has failed. And at that point, you're just going to replace the board, because with an obvious burn or a failed component or a blown resistor or cap, we know the board's bad. So we're just going to replace it. The other board over here is our defrost board. And if you'll remember from our first segment, we were talking about operation of the defrost board and exactly what it does. So I'm going to go over that again. And the defrost board basically goes in here and it monitors through a PTC sensor at the temperature of that cold point on the other side, which is inside the wine cooler. And it keeps that temperature from dropping so low that the water condenses out of the air and then it freezes on the cold point. So, and it will actually cut the voltage to those nodes so that it's able to warm up in there a little bit, just temporarily enough to melt the ice. The only failure mode you're going to see on this board, and again, and by the way, this one is all plug and play too. So everything in here is modular plug and play. No soldering involved whatsoever. If that board fails, what can happen is we'll build a lot of ice up on that cold plate back there. The ice will build up to the point where it starts hitting the fan. We get a whole bunch of racket. The fan stops moving. It can get that severe. So if you get a customer that says, hey, I let this unit run for a while, all of a sudden I get this, and it's just making all kinds of racket. I don't know what's going on back there. And I've got all this water in the bottom of my unit. Odds are pretty good that sensor has failed. And so you need to replace this board. The sensor itself probably won't ever fail because it's really a solid state component that we just don't have any failures on. But the board can fail. And again, if you see any burn marks in here on any of these boards, including the defrost board, and as you can see, by the way, here on this board, we have an IC timer chip. So again, it runs for a predetermined amount of time, shuts the voltage off for a certain amount of minutes so it can defrost. But if you see any burn marks or anything like that on any of these boards, obviously they need to be replaced. All right, I wanted to show you the front of the unit. Now, in keeping with our theme here, the control panel, this touch panel across the front, is also replaceable. And so is the door. And occasionally a customer will break the glass or it gets broken in transit. At that point, we have to change out the door. Basically, what we're going to focus on is the electrical portion, not so much the door. So in order to get to the electrical portion here in the door and on this touch panel here, and it's really sensitive, by the way, we're going to first pop off this hinge cap. And what you'll do is get a flat blade in here on the edge, work it up, and just pop it off. You've got a couple of catches here, and I think there's one here in the front. There's actually four. There's two here and here, and two here and here. So I'm going to set this aside, and you'll see this connector. Now that connector is wrapped with shrink wrap, so you're going to have to take a sharp knife, score the shrink wrap, peel it back, and then you can disconnect the male and female spades in here, and that will disconnect power into this panel. You don't have to put the shrink wrap back. You can. That's up to you. You just wrap it with some tape, whatever you want to do. So now that we've got that apart, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about how we get to the backside. And it looks like it's all one piece with a glass. Well, it sort of is, but it isn't. The front touch pads and everything are integrated into the glass, along with the light switch here. But what we're going to do is we're going to actually get to that circuit board. And you may ask, well, where is it? How do I get to it? You've got a rubber gasket here. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to peel part of that gasket back, and that will reveal our screw holes. So what you're going to do, and this is separate from the rest of this gasket here. So what we're going to do is we're just going to kind of take it and just pull it back. And don't be afraid of the seal. I've had many customers be afraid to pull on these seals. I'm not sure why they're scared. I've never had any issues with it. I just give it a good pull. It'll always pop back in. As you can see here in the center, there's a hard ridge. And that ridge just pops back into that groove. There's really nothing to it. So we got that side. Well, we need to pull this side off. So what we're going to do, we're just going to peel that back. As a matter of fact, I think just for illustration purposes, I'm just going to pull the whole thing out. So what you can do, set this aside, and again, the center ridge goes into that groove, and when you're done, you're just going to line it back up. Just take your thumbs and just kind of work it back into place, and you'll be fine. So we're going to leave that aside for now, and you're going to have a screw here, and what we're going to do is we're going to take that loose, and you see the holes here. And you might want to get a helper to kind of help you here with the door, which is what I'm doing today. And he's just going to hold the door steady for me. And what's happening here is I'm going to back this panel out. I'm going to take this other screw out. Okay. And watch for flying screws. Once you get this out, I don't know how much of a shot I can get here with the camera. This is our circuit board in here. These are our spring-loaded touch pins for inside the panel here. You have a screw here, and a screw here. There's three screws that hold it in. This is your PZO beeper for the beep when you hit the up and down for the temperature. Over here, we've got two connectors. This is not all one piece. You've got 6-volt DC and ground coming in on one, and then your comm line, which goes back to the your communications ribbon, which goes back to those circuit boards back there and provides power to this panel. So what you're going to do is you're going to slide those connectors off your pins, just grab the wires and just give them a gentle pull, and then they come off just like that. So there's a good shot of our panel and our connector. And then, of course, your screws that hold that board down. So you're just going to order this board. And you're going to back these screws out and take that off. And be careful. There's probably a piece of lamination plastic back here. When you take this off, you need to be careful. You note the order that it goes in. Because if you don't put that back correctly, that may interfere with the touch control on the other side. So you're just going to order just this board. And again, they just plug in here. There's really nothing to it. When you get ready to put it back in, you're going to line your screws up, put your screws in, and then you could slide your gasket in on this groove on the back here. And there's a good side shot of the groove. And what you'll do is just slide that gasket in there and just kind of keep feeding it until you get it in place. You're all done. That's it for the panel. I hope that this do-it-yourself video has helped you to repair your new Coldfront TWR-187SS wine cooler. If you have any questions or concerns, please contact EdStar at www.edstar.com.